was to educate 40 Haitian women living with disabilities. With project management, communication, entrepreneurship, and leadership training. And also, I use the fellowship experience to train senior business students by holding training on trainers. So, in 2015, while ending my community project, I decided to turn the project into an organization. See, this is why it is in professional terms. It is a personal idea turned into a project idea. A personal experience, project idea. A project idea turned into a winning project. A winning project turned into an organization. And an organization that is going to keep empowering people living with disabilities lives for a long-term impact. So, dear fellas, dear friends, partner organizations, to make a long story short, the biggest challenge that I experienced as a fellow prior to the program was the difficulties that I faced with my disability. Then I realized how difficult it is when you live with a disability. Through the implementation of my community projects, I heard and seen how women are complaining, struggling because of their disability issues. And I realized that as a fellow that has been impacted with this program, all the skills, I decided to have as a purpose in life to keep empowering women living with disabilities. And here's my suggestion for you, my recommendation. Success happens easier when we are connected. Nobody can succeed alone. We have to be a team. And then, this kind of success, you can only reach it when you work together. When we work together, we stay together, we progress together. Of course, we may encounter a lot of challenges. We may suffer together. But I can assure you, when you stick together, we will succeed together. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Look forward to your Q&A session as well. Next up is Joe. Joe is the principal deputy legislative counsel in the Office of Legislative Counsel in the state of California. He's been a longtime supporter of the PFP program, having hosted fellows from Russia and Ukraine, and fostering relationships between his office and the American Councils and the U.S. State Department. He's traveled to Ukraine and Armenia to help with legislative standards and has been instrumental in orienting new professional fellow hosts throughout our country in the United States. So, Joe.
For inviting me the opportunity to address such a distinguished audience of international fellows. And on behalf of the California Office of Legislative Counsel and myself, I wanted to say to the three legislative fellows that we had hosted in Sacramento, Chichaoua to Ben, Rina to Andre from Moldova, In 2010, my office first hosted a fellow from Ukraine, Yulia Moshan. She was an attorney. She is an attorney. She works for their parliament, Verna Rada, and worked in an office that was somewhat similar to the office that I worked for, preparing legislation for a parliament. Very bright person, very well-traveled, and I was in charge of providing her fellowship for that month. I hadn't really done that before, and so I wasn't really sure what was expected of me, and I kind of did a lot of it on my own, so I didn't do a project as well as I could have done. Nevertheless, she had a great time, and we still maintain professional and personal contact, even though she's on the other side of the world. Realizing that I'm going to need some help in providing a month-long itinerary for me to get a really good exposure to the California legislative process. I came back from the reciprocal outcome project and made a PowerPoint presentation of my travels and the places I've been. Many people in my office were very excited to hear what I learned, what I did, and who I met. One thing I'd like to point out, I felt when I went there, I was treated not as a tourist, not as a visitor or even a guest, but an honored guest. It was just such a great experience. I got introduced to some very smart people, very interesting people, and I came back with great stories to tell. One of the persons who I met had also been on a reciprocal project to the Library of Congress, and he works in the department. And I remember one story that he toured me around a lot of museums and churches, and his English was very good. He's a professor, I believe. He kept referring to some of the structures as very ancient structures. And I thought, really, maybe what he means is old. And so I thought, okay. So eventually he kept confusing me, and I eventually asked him, well, how old? And he said, well, this structure figured since 1000. And I asked, okay, 1500, 1600? And he says, no, 1000. Well, I kind of got from that an understanding. I'm from California. Our state's history is, well, maybe the early 1800s. So understanding and appreciating that his country's been around for a long time. And my state government's only been around for, the 1800s. Gave me greater appreciation for the history and the pride in his government that he had. I hadn't really been in a country that had such a long history. I was exposed to a lot of the customs and traditions, and a little bit of vodka as well, visiting that country, and I had a great time. I came back with personal relationships that I've been able to maintain. Yulia has asked me to write letters of recommendation for her in the past, and to edit some manuscripts that she's been working on in English. So maintaining some of those ties has been critical and has been important. I urge all of you to continue to stay in contact with not only your host families, if you have one, but also your host employers, host supervisors, to continue helping you out in your career. And realizing that I need assistance, I certainly made presentations to the rest of my office, and I was able to recruit additional people to help me. Ben, Andre, Irene will attest to the fact that I don't do it all by myself. In fact, the award I received, I really received it on behalf of my office. Other folks really got interested in it and helped put together a really good month-long project for the folks who came to visit us. We begin our program by contacting the fellows once they're in the host country, as soon as our American Council, which is the grantee in our case, lets us know who the fellows are. We start contacting them, asking them, well, what are your personal and what are your professional interests? And ours were somewhat diverse. So we found out Ben is a trademark attorney and arranged a visit to a trademark attorney for a luncheon and for a tour of a candy store. Irene has a strong interest in energy development in Ukraine. One of my friends happens to be a chief of staff to one of our energy commissioners, and so we arranged for a private luncheon where she discussed the energy development in Ukraine, and we discussed California's efforts in developing renewable energy to help us solve the energy demands of California. Andre is working with his parliament, and we organized some meetings with legislators and legislative committees so that he could understand how we do it in California. They also happen to be all three lawyers, and our office is a law office. So we took them to our state courts, state and federal courts, which have jury trials, something that's a little unique to California, well, not to California, but to the American government, and they don't have them in their country, so we got to attend some criminal trials, and they found out how justice is meted out in California style. I think one of the anecdotes I recall, we came in sort of towards the end of a state criminal trial. The defendant was getting a verdict. He was found guilty. And what did he do? What did he end up cursing his lawyer and cursing the judge even before he got sentenced? So, not a smart guy, but it was sort of an experience where we let people know that any American just can walk into the court and see how justice is handled before all the public. In addition, we make appointments with a lot of other California elected and appointed officials, most of whom just enjoy the opportunity to meet with such distinguished guests and to discuss social, political, economic, and personal interests of our fellows. We in turn developed personal contacts, since many of the folks that I helped set up meetings with, I might not have ever had an opportunity or reason to meet with them based upon my work. But participating in the program, we now have new contacts that we might not have ever had. So the benefits from the program to us have been both ways, both to our fellows and both to co-workers of my office, many of whom developed long-term relationships, many of whom are still in contact with individuals who we've been able to follow and track their careers and exchange emails. One gentleman, I think, that we hosted in 2012 ultimately received a Fulbright scholarship, and we were helpful in writing letters of recommendation. We, of course, had to balance a lot of the exciting and interesting meetings with some excursions. You may have heard some of these places, a little dreary place called San Francisco, a small park called Yosemite. I think Andre and Irena got down to a little village, Los Angeles, and my boss was very generous in her time and took all three of them to a vineyard area called Napa, where they got to sample some grape juice. Our experience working with the American Councils and the State Department has been extraordinary in innumerable ways. The staff of the Office of Legislative Council has developed a greater appreciation for international affairs, especially those that affect California. Many may not understand, but California is a very diverse state, the largest economy in the world, if we were our country ourselves, and has many different people from Vietnam, Slavic community from it that's in Sacramento. So we have already these connections. We posted two gentlemen from Armenia, and pointed out to them that we actually have some legislators who are from Armenian descent. And actually our state governor was Armenian, and have a little place called Glendale that's sometimes referred to as Little Armenia. So California is a great place to live. We finally, as part of our program, we asked each of the professional fellows to give us some feedback on our program, see if there's something that they liked, and any aspect of the program that they think we can still improve on. So you'll be getting an email soon that will ask for your advice, and hopefully you can be helpful to us. Not only do we appreciate being part of the program, but hope to be part of the continuing program as long as I'll be there, and appreciate the fact that it's a mutual exchange of culture, ideas, and values. Thank you very much.
Next will be Mohammed. Mohammed's a 2011 fellow who was placed at the Medical Knowledge Institute in Bedford, Virginia. head nurse for the Moroccan Ministry of Health, whose responsibility includes community health outreach and environmental health. Mohammed was also selected as one of 24 leaders from his region to participate in the Swedish Young Leaders Visitor Program. Mohammed.
Ladies and gentlemen, AFP colleagues, Department of State, staff, host organization, peace be upon you. Assalamu alaikum. تألمت I suffered, I learned, and I changed. That was the title of my personal movie that I was both the producer, the actor, and also the director. It was already 3 years that I spent in a small health center in a very isolated and remote area in Morocco, North Africa. My work consisted to show up every day in the health center, waiting for population, for patients to come in for consultation. I had a minimum interaction with my community outside of the health center. Once my shift is over, I go to my home. Sometimes I sit in the lonely and the only and the tiny cafe in the village. It was at the time my main objective is just to survive. Yeah, because a newspaper had ranked my rural community as the very remote area in Morocco in 2007. It was really very challenging to just be there. Even in those times when I felt helpless, I wondered, I asked myself what I could do for my community. I should do something for my community. And I still remember in 2010, a friend of mine informed me about an international program for health workers who are working in the field of the maternal and child in the rural area. The first opportunity I had the access to internet, I checked of course the information, and immediately I filled out the application in spite of my limited English at the time. 2 months later, Legacy International called me for an interview, and I still remember that interview conducted by Leila Buzz, who is over there. She selected me because she believed in me, even though my English was really limited. But because she believed in my deep passion to help my community and to serve it. In early 2011, here I am. I met in the fall of 2011, here I am in the United States for the first time in my life. I attended the fellowship in Roanoke, Bedford, in Carnegie Clinic, and Legacy International did really an amazing job, conducted me, driving me, and our 11 leaders in the public health from Egypt and Morocco. It was for me a kind of the eye-opener for my future. And also it was for me the once in life opportunity to go for war and also to break with the routine, the daily routine that I had really suffered from. So I learned in my first time in life how to write a proposal. It can be something really very superficial, but for me it was really very deep. I learned, for example, from Washington University, George Washington University, how to design a project based on a logic model. Also, I gained some golden contact, like from Medical Knowledge Institute, George Washington University, Legacy International, Cardiac Clinic, and so on. Briefly, once I'm back in late 2011 to my isolated village, believe me, I was a new me. I am no longer sitting in the health center waiting for my community. No, I'm out more. I'm trying to accept the invitation for the weekends. I'm playing soccer with the kids outside. I am very close to my community. I am really transformed. And then I believed on my God, why give people without changing what makes them? To change what makes them sick, we have to be very close to the population and to know in their environment, in their daily environments, and their social determinants of health, what really makes them sick. Then I decided that my first project will be dedicated for the health of children, and thus the Tamazight, which means in Berlin, the nation, the Tamazight School Health Club was born. It was such a great success that Medical Knowledge Institute and George Washington University recognized it. Actually, for doing more. So since 2011, I have been engaged in many and several projects that I designed and implemented in the spirit of the PFP experience. I will mention the awareness cancer program that I am very dedicated to. Why? One of the reasons is because my parents died from cancer. So I really dedicated myself to that program. The second one is the school health education. And the third one is the outreach community program, like the Health and Peace Hub. The Health and Peace Hub that we will have in its fourth edition next summer, gather people from US, Europe, and Morocco for a hike alongside the beaches in Morocco, and also raising awareness against cancer and doing many activities for the population that we meet, such as youth development and health campaign. Of course, the ride into this 5 years was not a smooth one. Yes, it was really, really challenging. And I still remember my favorite quote: don't limit your challenges, but challenge your limits. And let me share with you some of these challenges. When I came back, I tried to transfer what I learned with my colleagues and co-workers. And believe me, I still remember that resistance of change, and I invite them to think out of the box. The second one was balancing with my job requirement as a nurse and also my outreach activities. And the third one is finding the lack, actually, of funds to sustain my project. But on the other hand, I'm looking and I'm seeking to strengthen my network in US, in Morocco, and recently in Sweden. And I'm also looking I'm seeking some funds for my projects to try to replicate it in a national wide. Finally, there is. I believe that the BFP changed really my life, and I become a responsible and active citizen. I will finish by a quote that I'm living with. John Kennedy said, never ask what your country will do for you. Instead of this, ask what you will do for your country. Thank you so much.
But in a very democratic process, the participants decided on the order they were going to go in, and I acquiesced. Molly is a senior organization development consultant from Detroit, Michigan. She's hosted two professional fellows from Egypt and Israel who helped run a business simulation program. And in turn, she visited Egypt, Israel, and the Palestinian territories to deliver workshops on professional development. Please welcome Molly.
For welcoming our alum group to your Congress. This is truly your time, and you have been such an inspiration to us as we have enjoyed these past several days with you. And it is truly my hope that our stories inspire you to go home and make the kinds of impacts that will one day find you here on this stage. I'd like to share with you a story about my project. And it's a story about tenacity and persistence, patience, and most importantly, it's a story about the power of the relationships that will support you in seeing through to make a greater impact than you could potentially ever imagine. 8 years ago, I was a stepmother. I was 28 years old, and I was taking my 17-year-old daughter on a flight to Chicago so that she could explore a career opportunity in ophthalmology and optometry. That's a story, that's a professional career about vision and eyesight. And little did I know that that moment in that trip would actually take me on a journey for the next 8 years, exploring career development and what it means to truly have a personal and professional vision for your future. You see, her high school had an interesting perspective on career development for young people. Her administrators believed that 15, 16, 17, and 18-year-old students could not possibly be a good investment in terms of investing resources, time, and money to support their career development at such an early age. The perspective was that these young people were living the dream. They had no responsibilities, they enjoyed their friendships, and their strategy at that school would be to let those students experience life, and in their 20s, when they realized the real challenges before them, then they expected that they would be ready to appreciate the journey that was before them. This deeply saddened me. And as a result, I went through a process of exploring what kinds of realities existed out there for young people. And I learned a lot of things, but one of the things that I learned was that I too could be a part of the solution to create change. And so I set forth with my project. And little did I know how much this scholarship program would truly amplify the impact of what I would do. You see, I started out thinking that I was going to work with high school students. I had recently completed a master's degree, I had skills in training and development, and I thought that I would go ahead and develop a program for young people and partner with my local community college to be able to bring resources to them to support their future. I called it Future State. So I began the journey, and you heard so much about how important it is just to take that first step. Many of you have already taken many steps towards your dreams, just as I had at that time. But what I learned quickly was that the challenge is real, and it's not always an easy thing to do. And it certainly isn't easy to do if you try to go it alone. So I thought that I had good partnership, I thought I could actually make a difference, but what I learned was that the program wasn't getting the kind of traction that I needed for it to truly make an impact. And so there was an interesting twist and turn. You see, people in relationships, strangers that become friends, and people that you may not have seen for many, many years, often suddenly appear in the times that we need them most. It reminds me so much of Dr. Peter Cohn's statement yesterday in regards to what it means to ask yourself the question, what would you do if you knew you could not fail? And so what happened was, I encountered a professor that I had done some work with a while back. She had advised me during my master's program as I was completing my studies in organizational development. And I was sharing with her what I was trying to accomplish. And she shared with me what she was trying to accomplish as well. And it turned out we had a shared vision, but we had something different in mind. I really wanted to work with a youth population, and she really wanted to work with an adult population. And so, sometimes when you're on your journey, things don't always look the way that you expect them to. And so, despite those differences, I moved forward with her, and we began to work on a program that impacted the state of Michigan during its most significant economic downturn. The program was envisioned by our governor, Governor Rick Snyder, who is very versed in entrepreneurship and the former CEO of the Gateway Computers. And one thing that he knew was that in order for entrepreneurs to be successful, sometimes they first needed to have a safe place to fail. And in our state, what we were faced with was a 14% unemployment rate. It was an incredibly high unemployment rate when you consider about 5% to be healthy. And so, we were losing incredibly talented people through other parts of the country, and this program was designed to help retain them and help them to make a transition into Michigan's new economy, which was largely made up of entrepreneurial startups and small business and growth companies. And what we knew was that people who had experience in corporate organizations frequently failed at their first step out into the entrepreneurial world. And I knew this because as career pathways they go, sometimes they take interesting twists and turns, and I too had been involved in a couple of different entrepreneurial ventures. I had co-founded a nonprofit organization, and I was partnered to a technology startup with some colleagues that I had worked with 7 years prior. So we embarked upon this journey to help professionals navigate career transition, and for 5 years, we worked together to help 525 professional adults navigate a career transition journey. Many of them had been unemployed for 18 months or longer and suffering from the loss and impact of their families. And by completing our program, we were successful in actually landing new opportunities within 3, 6, and 9 months of completing our program. 83% of them had landed a new career direction of their choice. And so for us, we employed and created jobs for 15 people. We welcomed 3 professional fellows from this program to join us for their internship experience. We had 972 volunteers from our community that helped to integrate these professionals and support them as they navigated experiences that they had never had before. Without the support of all of those others, we wouldn't have been able to make the impact that we needed to make. And without that journey taking a twist and turn that was totally unexpected for me, I wouldn't have understood what it was that young people really needed to do to prepare themselves for the future that they would experience when they were 40, 50, 60, and even 70 years old. The other thing that I didn't know was that I would wind up here. I didn't know that part of my career program was going to support young people and professionals from around the world. And so what happened was, thank you. And so what happened was, not only did we host fellows from the program, but we welcomed a fellow on return for 6 months from Tunisia to work closely with us to support her master's thesis